This video is brought to you by extremefinitism.com. Why 0.9 recurring does not equal 1. 0.9 recurring can be thought of as an endless series, where each term in the series corresponds to one of the digits, one of the nines that is. Now the decimal system can supposedly have more than one way to represent the same number. So here 0.9 recurring and 1 are supposedly the same number. This is far from the elegance that we should expect from the decimal system, which is one of the fundamental systems in mathematics. Now let's take a look at a series. Here we've got 1, minus 1, plus 1, minus 1, and that carries on indefinitely. And we've got series B where we've got 1, plus 2, plus 4, plus 8, and so on. Note that series A and series B have the same underlying structure as 0.9 recurring. Each is an endless series with an expression defined for the nth term. In series A, the nth term alternates between plus 1 and minus 1. And in series B, the nth term is getting bigger and bigger. Even though these objects are of the same type, only ones that are said to converge are chosen to be part of the decimal system. Again, this is far from elegant. A well-defined solution that supports a structure 0.9 recurring should support all objects of that same fundamental type. It shouldn't matter if the terms in a series are getting smaller or not. It's the underlying mathematical structure that matters, not the numbers and expressions that happen to be in the structure. Now let's examine a series that does not end in a bit more detail. Here we've got 1, minus 1, plus 1, minus 1, and so on. The terms go on endlessly. There is no endpoint, which means there's no last term. As there's no endpoint, there is no numeric value that can be said to equate to the sum of the series. There is no sum. The sum up to the nth term is called a partial sum. So we can actually add up the first term on its own, the first two terms, the first three terms, the first four terms, and so on. And these are called partial sums. We can form an expression for this partial sum. Here we've got Sn, the sum to the nth term, is a half plus a half times minus 1 to the power n minus 1. By examination of how the partial sum varies as n increases, we can study the nature of this endless object. And it could be said that the partial sum expression defines the series. Let's have a look at the variable and fixed parts of the partial sum expression. Here we've got 0.3 recurring, which is 3 tenths, 3 hundredths, and so on. Now, the sum to the nth term is given by the expression 1 third minus 1 over 3 times 10 to the power n. If the variable part of the partial sum expression gets smaller as n increases, then the series is said to converge. And in this case, it does. For a converging series, the fixed part of the partial sum expression is called the limit. And so here, the fixed part, which is the third, is the limit of our series. As n increases, the partial sum gets closer to, but never reaches the limit. This means the series 0.3 recurring cannot equate to 1 third. Now let's take another look at 1, minus 1, plus 1, minus 1, the alternating series. Here we've got the sum to the nth term, as we saw before, is a half plus a half times minus 1 to the power n minus 1. And another series, 1 plus 2 plus 4 plus 8 and so on, the sum to the nth term is given by the expression 2 to the power n minus 1. Each of these expressions for the sum to the nth term has a fixed part and a variable part. If the series does not converge, The fixed part is not called the limit, but some people do call it what the limit would be if the series converged. So let's define a formal notation to use with the partial sum expression. The partial sum expression consists of a fixed part and a variable part. And so the number 1.23, for example, could be represented as PSE 1.23 plus 0, or it could just be left as 1.23 for short. Obviously, this PSE format is not required when there is no variable part. The series 1 plus 2 plus 4 and so on could be defined by PSE with a fixed part of minus 1 and a variable part of 2 to the power n. So it supports fixed length decimals and endless series. When working with two endless series in their expanded form, which is a fairly informal way of working, it's important to line up the first term of one series with the first term of another, and this PSE format enforces this rigour. Here we've used the PSE in an equation to show what 1/3 actually equates to. And 1/3 equates to the PSE plus 1 over 3 times 10 to the power n. Informally, this could be stated as 0.3 recurring to the nth term plus 1 over 3 times 10 to the power n for any n. And so we can use this PSE representation to ensure mathematical rigour. Here we've got 0.9 recurring and 1 in PSE format. By simply comparing the PSE representations for 0.9 recurring and 1, we can see that they are different. Informal notation doesn't contain enough information for rigorous mathematics. For example, it seems we can get to 9.9 recurring via these two different methods, 10 times 0.9 recurring and 9 plus 0.9 recurring. But now if we do this with more rigour using the PSE representation, we get two different results. In the first case, where we've multiplied by 10, the variable part of the PSE has changed. We've now got minus 1 over 10 to the power n minus 1. And in the second case, where we've added 9 to the series, the variable part of the PSE is still minus 1 over 10 to the n. So in the top case there, the sum to the first term is going to be 10 minus 1, which is 9. In the second case, the sum to the first term is 10 minus 1/10, which gives 9.9. So you can see how these two differ. So why did people think that 0.9 recurring equals 1? Well, the decimal system was introduced in the 16th century, and for hundreds of years afterwards, many students rightly struggled with the notion that 0.9 recurring equals 1. The claim that an endless series can reach its limit forms a contradiction, as an endless object cannot end by definition, otherwise it wouldn't be endless. Despite this, series like 0.3 recurring and 0.9 recurring were considered to have fixed values equal to their series limit. The implications of this mistake are huge. Some proofs for 0.9 recurring equals 1 were wrongly considered to be rigorous. The validity of many other proofs must now be considered highly questionable. But why didn't mathematicians pick up on this problem before? Well, misleading words have clouded mathematicians' judgment, preventing them from analysing problems with clarity and rigour. These words include infinitely many, infinite, to infinity, continuous, analog, forever, infinitesimal, and many more. This problem is just the tip of the iceberg. The most basic maths principles need to be reworked to remove the infinite. For example, a simple geometric line cannot be divided into infinitely many parts. It can only be divided into a variable number of finite parts. This video was brought to you by extremefinitism.com. in association with Reveal computer software.